everybody, welcome back. So if you're wondering why I'm here, as opposed to where I usually hang out with my bird, she's about ready to take a bath right now, so for obvious reasons, I'm here. But in terms of Kiss, this being 1976, obviously the year before for Kiss Alive, sold a gazillion copies, it went platinum, band's finally getting paid, so that's always a good thing. And they definitely become a household name. So much so that a certain famous producer, that being Bob Ezrin, got a call from somebody that would work with him, who was supposed to, like, you know, scout out bands that he could produce. And, you know, that person called him saying, "Hey, man, Kiss, they're hot right now. You should definitely, you know, talk to them and perhaps produce an album." And coincidentally, 2 weeks after that phone call, Bob Ezrin met them at an establishment. They were doing an interview, and, you know, they got together and they talked, and then they set about producing Kiss's Destroyer, perhaps, you know, without a doubt, their most popular album. But it definitely wasn't that initially. You know, it sold almost 900,000 copies pretty instantly, but then it became really, really stagnant and just started to drop. It was really only saved thanks in part to the song Beth, Peter Criss's ballad on the B-side, that absolutely exploded, and then thus the album as well. So much so that the song, I believe it was a People's Choice Awards, they won, and then the song eventually started being played in elevators, so, you know, totally just bombastic in terms of popularity. But I want to get back to Bob Ezrin here for a sec. If you don't know him, he's from the Alice Cooper Band fame, and solo Alice Cooper has been the producer in this time right here. The year prior, he did Alice Cooper's Welcome to My Nightmare, and then obviously Destroyer here, and then for the next 2 years, he'll go back to Alice Cooper for Ghost to Hell, Lace and Whiskey, and then in 1979, he would produce Pink Floyd's The Wall. So he's got a pretty incredible track record. But let's bring up those initial albums that I talked about. Welcome to My Nightmare, Destroyer, Ghost to Hell, Lace and Whiskey. You know what those four albums have in common? They all had a ballad. And you know what each of those ballads did? They topped the charts. So never underestimate Bob Ezrin when it comes to producing a ballad. He will get you to the charts, right? But for Bob Ezrin, you know, he's going to get a great album out of you, but you're going to have to work for it. He's going to put you through the ringer. He'll be your best friend, and he'll also be your worst enemy. The band talked about it. They said that it's musical boot camp. You know, he's got a whistle around his neck. He's putting them through music school, you know, like learning all the basics because they really didn't know much of that at all. And, you know, if it's going to take 50 takes, it's going to take 50, basically like the James Cameron, if you will, when it comes to producing. And then, you know, obviously he has his specialty, his flavors of, you know, sound effects that you definitely hear on this album. But when this came out, it was rather divisive. You know, fans thought it was, you know, way too polished, kind of sellout-y. You know, it doesn't really help when, you know, you hear the Bob Ezrin in it. You know, perhaps it's too out of left field for Kiss. But it also did attract a lot of fans. And obviously, as time progresses, I think that the crowd that really did not like it, I think has died down a lot. Because it's pretty unanimous from what I've seen. This is like a top three album for Kiss fans. Now, for me, I do think it's a good album. I get enjoyment out of it. However, I'm not in that camp that thinks it's like great or fantastic. You know, the 9 songs on the album, 2 of which I'm kind of like, eh! So, you know, in terms of like the 1970s albums, this probably won't even be in my top 3 for album rankings. This probably won't be in my top 5, but it's still a good album, and as I said, I definitely do get enjoyment out of it. One of the things that also people really love, and then this absolutely stood out for the album, is the album cover itself. An oil painting by Ken Kelly, who worked on a creepy comic book, that creepy series, that one of the people that was working on this album, he wanted a certain artist. His name was Frank Frazetta, to do the album cover, but his asking price was like way too steep. It was crazy. So the person, I forget his name, but he went up into the comic shop and then he saw that creepy comic. He's like, wow, that's a great artist right there. So he called him up. His name, obviously, Ken Kelly. And coincidentally, he's the cousin of Frank Frazetta. So, you know, small world, right? So yeah, he did the oil painting of Destroyer. And then obviously he would do it again for Kiss's Love Gun. But sadly, he passed away. So rest in peace. But he gave us some tremendous artwork for sure. But as for the album, like I said, it's a good album. I do get enjoyment out of it, but I don't think it's that fantastic. But again, that's just my opinion. So without further ado, let's get started. All right, you open up the album with Detroit Rock City. This is partly inspired by an unfortunate tragic incident in which a person died in a car accident outside of a Kiss concert in Detroit. And you hear that in the sound effects for the intro of this song. And really, for the most part, the band wanted the sound effects to pad out the album. The album as is, it's 33 minutes and some change. But I take without the effects that happened throughout this album, you might be looking at 30 minutes and some change. So a little over a Dress to Kill album. So they felt the need to pad out the album. But, you know, with the sound effects, especially for this song, it's definitely ahead of its time for how they worked it out. So in the intro, you hear a person washing the dishes, and then they turn on the radio. And the news reporter is talking. And that reporter, by the way, is actually Bob Ezrin talking. And he's talking about the accident that happened. And a young person died and with like a truck accident. And the trucker's fine and everything. But the person died. And, you know, it was tragic. So then the person turns off the radio. They go outside. You hear the jingling of their keys. They open up their truck. And then they go through their cassette. And they play Kiss Alive, Rock and Roll All Night. You hear the engine rumming, the starting of it all. And all that is real. It's a person, when they're making the album, it just had a recorder on, and they're doing all these scenarios that I just talked about. So like I said, it's very, very ahead of its time for how unique that take is. But once you're down with the effects, and then you hear the guitars and the drums going. It's just very, very rocking, right? And Paul Stanley, he sounds incredible on the song. Super just strong and powerful. Just great. And you're following this person from 9 o'clock to 12 midnight. So, you know, they wake up at 9. It's all dark. The only light that's illuminating is the radio. And then at 10 o'clock, you know, they're drinking and they're smoking. And once you get to 11 o'clock, you know, they're in their car driving down High 95 and just going fast and fast and fast, but to them it's still too slow. And then 12 o'clock, we're almost there to the midnight show, but then he sees truck lights come ahead and he's like, well, I guess that's it. And then the song stops, and then you get this loud car crash sound effect to it all. But throughout it all, person in question, very, very excited to go to this midnight concert show, keeps talking about how, he can hear on the radio his favorite song playing. And for that part, it's Paul and Gene singing, Gene saying get up and then get down. And Paul is talking about how people are leaving their seats and getting up on their feet. And throughout the song, you might come to realize that, wow, the guitars are very, very powerful and have quite a range to them. And that's because a piano is actually playing with them to give it that sort of a more dynamic sound to it, which I'm sure at the time people thought that was kind of like a sellout-ish. But hey, man, it totally works. Really, really elevates it. And then Gene Simmons, he talked about with his bass playing on this song. He said it was something unlike anything he ever did. Very R&B. You could totally hear it. That's just like another Bob Ezrin thing. And speaking of another Bob Ezrin thing, Ace Frehley's guitar work, very flamenco. And, you know, the band just thought, like, Bob, you're fucking insane. You know, like, we're not doing Spanish guitar here. And he's like, oh, Nick, trust me, right? And once it got pieced together with the drumming, It was magic that the band couldn't believe it. But as for Detroit Rock City itself, absolutely rocking. Like I said, Paul's great. You know, Gene's parts to it. The drumming, by the way, Peter Criss is an animal on this album. He's talked about it with how much, you know, out of it he was when making this. And then obviously Ace's guitar work is great as well. So a very, very rocking song. All right, the next song is King of the Nighttime World. So this song was actually first written by a band called the Hollywood Stars. Bob Ezrin liked the song. Didn't care too much for the band, though. So he's kind of like, oh, hey, if you guys ever break up, if you wouldn't mind giving me the song, that'll be much appreciated. The band did eventually break up, and Bob Ezrin did get the song, and he reworked the lyrics to better fit Paul Stanley's character. And hey, man, let me tell you something. For this song, you want to talk about commanding in Paul Stanley's voice? He's just very confident singing this song. And even a bit Broadway-ish with how he delivers the lines, and you just got the marching sound, the marching beat of Peter's drums going on here. But for Paul Stanley, you know, for this song, he's with this girl, they're finally away from various distractions that he names and talks about, and, you know, they're finally together, and, you know, they can be in love. And, you know, he's singing with such, you know, power about being, you know, king of the nighttime world, and that she's going to be the headlight queen, and you know, her secret dream's going to come true. Now, interesting tidbit here: the lion headlight queen, that was actually from the Hollywood Stars, so that wasn't changed. But for that line, it was because there was, for the band, at one night in a dark alley, a band member was getting it on with a groupie. And somebody decided to turn on their car headlights to, you know, get them out of the moment. And the guy just started cracking up. He's like, oh, shit, I gotta write this down, you know. So you get the line headlight queen right there. So that's kind of funny. But this song right here, it's a banger. All right, speaking of fun, you got the song God of Thunder. To think that this was written and almost sung by Paul Stanley, to think that initially would have been his theme song. Well, thank God it wasn't, because Gene Simmons kills this. He nails it out of the park here. But I did feel a little bad, you know, when I was reading about it, because Paul, he talked about when he wrote the song. He was like, man, it's going to be my theme song. It's going to be incredible. He was playing it to Bob Ezrin, and then he slowed it down, and Bob, he was just like, man, that's a great song. We're going to have Gene Simmons sing it. And Paul, he's just like, what the fuck, man? But then he's like, you know, when he heard Gene Simmons sing it, he's like, all right, maybe that is the right call to make. But for this song right here, you know, Gene, he's just... like, you want to talk about what a God of Thunder should sound like, right? You want to talk about what the demon should sound like. Just, you know, dark, heavy, ominous. Talking about, you know, born out of the wasteland, raised by the demons. You know, God of Thunder and the rock and roll, he's going to take your virgin soul. I command you to kneel. Very... dude, which most part of this album is, it's a very theatrical. And throughout the song, you have Bob Ezrin's kids. They're in the studios with walkie-talkies, and Bob had them, you know, make monster noises and say stuff. So that plays out through here. Now, I do understand, I suppose, there is a valid criticism with this album that you can have, to which these sound effects, you can have an argument that says, oh, this is flavorful, you know, it's a nice additive. Or you can have another argument which says, this is distracting, this is unnecessary. So I can definitely see that. I don't really feel that way. However, I can totally understand, especially when you listen to God of Thunder, and then all of a sudden you hear kids. But I do appreciate, and I do like that they are in there, because it gives it a nice juxtaposition with these innocent sounding kids, but they do sound kind of spooky just because they're so low in the sound, as my dog's going crazy right now. And then just with Gene Simmons, his, you know, total evil ruler approach to this song, and it fantastic live, watching him and then spitting out his blood. But great song. All right, this is one of those songs that I've talked about where I'm just like, I don't think so. This is Gene Simmons' Great Expectations. The only interest I find of the song, besides it being on the end of the A side, so you can just turn it off and then flip it over again without having to readjust between songs, is a quote that Bob Ezrin gave about the song. He said that this is the equivalent of the scene Dance of the Hippos in the Mickey Mouse Fantasia movie. I was very surprised and quite pleased when I read that, because God of Thunder, you know, the good song that came on before this, I swear, I think of Fantasia. I think of Chernabog, the devil in Fantasia, when I hear God of Thunder. So I was quite shocked when I saw him bring up a reference to the movie and it being the Dance of the Hippos equivalent to the, you know, Great Expectations. But for the song itself, you're with this woman. She's in the audience and she's watching each band member play their respected instruments. And she wishes that she was the instruments because she's watching how their fingers move. And it's like, oh man, that can be me type of thing. And then at the end, Gene, you know, like they lock eyes and he's like, oh, your dream is about to come true. Just like, you know, I suppose what I really don't care about it, it's just the ballad lullaby-ness of it. And then especially the chorus. I don't really care for how Gene Simmons sings the title track. I find it kind of annoying. And then the chorus at the end with the choir, it seems to go on for like 20 minutes. And I'm just done with it. I'm done. You know, I have warmed up to it, but most times than not, it's a skip for me. All right, this song, Flaming Youth. I don't really care about it either. This is the other song where I'm kind of like, eh. But it's definitely a lot better than Great Expectations. But I don't really know why I don't care for this song. Maybe it's just the way it's delivered. I don't know. I haven't been able to put my finger on it. But this is basically Kiss's version of Department of Youth off of Alice Cooper's Welcome to My Nightmare. And I will reference that album again at the end of the album. Because for this song, you know, you're following this kid and his parents, they think he's stupid and lazy. So everybody's just writing him off. Like, you're just a stupid kid. You're not going to get anywhere in life. You know, scram. But for him, he's like, hey, you know something? The power I have, it's in my age. I'm decked in leather. I'm going to rally a bunch of other youth and start this rebellion as I carry the flag of, you know, youth anarchy. And we're going to storm the world. We're going to burn it as flaming youth. Just keep growing higher and higher and higher. So, you know, it's always the fun conversation of how old people are so scared about young people and how they're destroying the world and shit. But one of the other interesting things about this song is the background vocals are by Dick Wagner, a phenomenal guitarist. He's been on Alice Cooper albums and, you know, with Bob Ezrin as well. And he'll show up on a couple other songs on this album. But it is a case to be made when it comes to this, because Bob Ezrin does do uncredited roles. So, you know, if I was to say, oh, this, you know, great guitar work by Ace Frehley, right? It might be Dick Wagner playing, you know, at a part because of times that are uncredited, which was the case here. But from what I can tell, the songs that I see Dick Wagner talk about are the songs that I know. But for the song itself, I think it's just okay. Or at least this song I do enjoy. This is Sweet Pain by Gene Simmons. And it's a definite Gene Simmons song here. You know, it's about like BDSM and all that shit. You know, he's with his partner. They've been doing it every night. And, you know, pleasure is pain type of thing. But I just, like, really love how he sings this song. It sounds like he's totally into it. I'm sure that's probably what he was doing. And especially how he sings the chorus, you know, like the whole sweet pain, my love will drive you insane. I don't know who's singing on the background, though. There's a man and a woman. I don't know who that is. But yeah, he's definitely kind of got this sway to it all. You know, you can definitely sort of rock your head to this. It's got that type of attitude. And Dick Wagner's playing guitar on this song as well. however, the interesting part is that Ace Frehley did the guitars for this song. And then he sent it in for Bob Ezrin. But Ace said he wasn't too proud of it. He just thought it was okay. But it wasn't until Ace really heard the album and then this song, and he's like, what the fuck? That's not my guitar playing. Well, what's this? So it was Dick Wagner playing it. And so Ace called Gene. He's like, what the fuck, man? And then Gene gave this excuse of like, well, we were trying to look for you, but we couldn't find you type of thing. Yada, yada, yada. So, you know, Ace was pissed about that. But Dick Wagner, he'll come on for one more song on this album. But hey, man, he's a great guitarist, and it's definitely some good guitar playing on this song. All right, here's a great song. I really love this song, though perhaps I can understand why people might think it's bloody annoying. This is Shouted Out Loud, but I just think this is like a great anthem, right? This definitely has the feel of Rock and Roll All Night, which is that fun energy and the voices and the instruments. And like just the story itself is just, you know, just get up and party. You know, if you're feeling down and out, if you're lonely, feeling stressed, you know, life's got you down, just screw it. Screw all that. Screw all the rules. Invite your friends. Throw a party at the neighborhood. Just have a great time. Just very, very energetic and fun. And, you know, just the way that they sing the title track, just so enthusiastic with the shout it out loud. It was kind of funny reading, like, Gene Simmons came up with it, and, like, Paul and Bob Ezrin was like, what are we shouting? And then, like, Gene's like, who cares, you know, just, like, shout whatever, you know, shout out loud, whatever it may be, just scream it up to the heavens if you want. It's that type of song. But man, you want to talk about a party song? This is definitely it, man. I really enjoy this song. All right, this song, The Moneymaker, right? Beth, this would be the last song, by the way, that Dick Wagner plays on this. Beautiful ballad, you know, played to this day. Peter Chris sounds like he's about to break down and cry singing about this. But I don't really want to talk about that. Because everybody's talking about it to death at this point. What I want to talk about is the backstory to this song. There's some pretty neat details on this song. So this, before being heavily reworked in the lyrics by Bob Ezrin, this was actually a song made by Peter Criss's old band, Chelsea. And one of the members, Mike Brand, he had a wife named Becky, who would constantly call him and she just constantly interrupt their sessions and their rehearsals, so much so that another band member, Stan Pendridge, began writing things down in what he called his wizard book. And what he was writing down was just the best responses one could say to an aggravated wife that misses you. So, you know, Mike would call her, and then he'll just be reading stuff off of the wizard book. He's like, yes, honey, I know that the band's playing. I miss you, sweetie. I'll be back in a couple hours. It's okay. I'll come home to your arms. Yes, I'll be right there type of thing. So that, I find that quite hilarious, you know. And then if you read the lyrics in a sarcastic sort of, you know, like barroom setting of like, oh crap, here's my wife again. I just got to read this off. It's very funny, and I would love to hear that sarcastic approach to this song. That would be quite funny. But yeah, Peter Criss was singing parts of this song in a car ride with Gene. And he's like, holy shit, what's that? And he's like, oh, it's Becky. He's like, well, what the fuck's a Becky? You know, like, we're talking about Jeff Beck? He's like, oh, no, it's a person's wife. He's like, well, change it to Beth, right? And then, you know, Bob Ezrin, we worked a lot of the lyrics, but hey, man, fuck it, right? Like, what did I say? Never underestimate Bob Ezrin when it comes to making a ballad. Definitely the case right here. To end the album off, you have the song Do You Love Me? Good song. You know, Paul Stanley sings it. He sounds great. He definitely gives it the emotion. He's with this woman who just invests herself in all the luxuries that fame has to offer since she's been with him. You know, she loves the watches, you know, the jewelry, the cars, the fame, having her photos in magazines. The world around knows her. She's just living it up, right? And Paul Stanley, he sees that. He's like, man, you love all this stuff, but do you love me, though? So that's the premise of this song right here. And it's so well done. You get this cool echo radio effect when talking about her looking like a queen with sunglasses on. And but the lingering question, do you love me? Well, that never gets answered, so it's up to you to decide right here. But the album, it ends kind of interestingly. It's, you got this whirlwind effect that, it sounds like it was straight out of the song Years Ago off of Welcome to My Nightmare. So there's the reference I was going to talk about there. And, you know, you got these, like, creepy sounds going on, and then you have Great Expectations. I believe it's played backwards. And then other songs, too, that go on. It's kind of like Whirlpool, sort of vortex going on to end the album off. So, yeah, it's kind of interesting. Unnecessary? Yeah. But it's kind of interesting. But it's a good song to end off the album. Alright, so there you go. Kisses Destroyer. Let me know what you think. You love it? You hate it? Let me know. Otherwise, I will see you guys next time for Rock and Roll Over. Alright guys, take care.